Arjuna puts forth few questions. In this session, we discuss about the second chapter of Bhagavad Gita.
Mm-hmm.
In the first chapter, Krishna was explaining about, like, Arjuna was giving some doubts, right? How can I kill my relatives? I can be happy after killing my relatives, like that. And then he finally says that I will get sinful reactions and something like that, right? And then he says, and in the second chapter, he says, like, he was not sure what to do. He says, which is good and which is bad, I'm not able to decide. And then Krishna says, like, kutastvaka smalamitam, means, how come these impurities come upon you? No, we'll just keep it formally, okay? Because as a Kshatriya, Arjuna should fight for establishing dharma, right? It's that every person who is doing some work, he has certain duties. Just like a soldier has certain duty, a police officer has certain duties. Now, Kshatriya has certain duties. As a householder, we have certain duties. As a housewife, we have certain duties. Like that, every person in this material world has certain duties. But Arjuna is saying that finding some kind of reasons for not to give an excuse, but it will be coming on the as a roadblock to his duties. And Arjuna is confused, like, doing my duty will be taking away my pleasure, means I will be more miserable if I perform my duty. Sometimes as a father, we have to, they have to take some decisions against children, like cutting their funds or something, like pocket money, and also chastising them sometimes, not physically, either, like being hard on them, because if they want to educate, something like that. Or like their certain duties, they demand certain kind of, some actions which seems to be temporarily affecting our happiness. The other people will misunderstand us, people will blame us. But is it right to avoid such duties just for the sake of others, not to displease others? Arjuna is like, Arjuna's case, if he performs his duties properly as a Kshatriya, not to establish dharma, if he performs, he has to kill his own relatives. He has to kill his own martial teacher, and he has to kill his own grandfather. So that kind of indecisions may come in our lives also. So during that time, as per Bhagavad Gita's philosophy, we need a counselor. We need a certain person, a guru. A guru is friend, philosopher, and counselor. A friend will, share with you, gives you knowledge. When we are dealing with problems, we will be so engrossed with those problems that we will not be able to see if we are doing right or wrong. So we need an opinion of a third person. Like, third person will be, because of the anxiety, we may not be able to take proper decisions. But if you consult a third person who is our well-wisher and who is knowledgeable, then they can give right direction. Do this way, do this way. That is kind of friend. And secondly, philosopher. Philosopher means he knows according to, what is philosophy. Philosophy means dharma, means what is good. Dharma means the law that is given by the, either by the, as per dharma. Dharma means dharmantu sakshat bhagavat pranitam. What God said in scriptures, that is dharma. And that it has a certain kind of philosophy. What does that philosophy tells? What does that philosophy, if you see Ramayana or anything, Lord Ram always even though it is not not going to give him happiness, like for suppose he sends Sita Devi to forest, but as per his personal opinion, he wants Sita Devi with him, but for the sake of higher principles, for the sake of so that to set an example for others, because he is in a kingly position, he has to be in an exemplary manner. So that's why, like, the people should not see any minor mistake or blasphemy or blame him or point out him for any of the mistake. That's why he wants to be exemplary. That's why he said, okay, if Sita being problem with me is going, if it is a issue, then for the sake of higher principles, I will sacrifice my family life. He does that. What is the criteria for that? That is, a king should be exemplary. That is given in the Shastras. Okay. And it is said, Dharman Sakshat Bhagavat Pandit. So a guru is one who is also friend, a philosopher and guide. Okay, philosopher means he knows about what is the scriptures are teaching, what is the right thing to do. So that kind of opinion we can need. And guide means who knows our specific nature, who knows our condition. All laws are not applicable to everybody. Okay, now for suppose some people have some problems, a rich person and a poor person cannot, all the laws should not be the same. For suppose if there is a mistake done by a rich person and the same mistake done by a poor person, and if you give fine of $1,000 for that mistake, then a poor person will struggle to pay that amount of money, but a rich person, is for him nothing, $1,000 is nothing, and he'll pay that money and he will commit the same mistake again. Okay, means we should have, a guru will have proper knowledge about our present situation, our capabilities, our limitations, and what is beneficial for us and what is not beneficial for us, and what is our nature, and everything he will have an idea. So we should have a guru, to give proper guidance at the time of crisis in our lives. So Arjuna, in this case, he is not able to decide what is good for him. So he says to Arjuna, Karpanya dosho pahata svabhava pratya midvam dharma samuda cheta yashreyashan nishchitam bruhitan me shishyaste ham shadi mam tvam prapannam. So he says, I do not know what is my duty and what is not, and I'm due to miserly weakness, I'm not able to decide what is good for me. So I'm surrendering unto you. Please instruct me. Now, Krishna and Arjuna are well-known friends. And why Arjuna has to surrender unto him? Why, Krishna could, if Arjuna and Krishna are friends, Krishna would have directly helped his friend by just suggesting him what to do. But that friendly talk does not work in this kind of situation. Because if a friend gives a suggestion, we have a choice. We may follow or not follow. But if we accept somebody as a guru, means we are totally surrendering to him. So guru means guru means gravity. So we have to give such an importance to the instructions of a guru. We should try our best to follow the instructions of guru. Only when we follow the instructions of guru, then Krishna will be pleased with us. And the problems in our life will be very easy to overcome. So that is the criteria. Then when Arjuna surrenders to Krishna, then Krishna first Krishna smiled and spoke to Arjuna in a smiling way. You are speaking like a learned person, but you are a fool, so. And he says, he gives the knowledge of body and spirit. You are concerning about only the body, but all these people are spirit souls. And you are also not this body. And for any problem that we come across in our life, we only identify with the present situation, oh, I'm related to this family and these are people who are related to this body are my relatives. And I have to, if I do this, I will get this benefit. If I do that, I will get that benefit. That kind of analysis we make and we take decision. And Krishna says, the learned persons will not lament for that which is not to be worried about. Now, when we come across something, we watch news and we lament, and we come across some family problems or somebody getting some great, financial or social reputation or financial benefit. That may instigate some kind of not a pleasing situation, like kind of inferiority or some kind of when we get something, when you achieve something, we get superiority complex. So all these things, like we worry so much about the things that we cannot do anything about. Like in the same way, Arjuna is worrying about killing his relatives. He's thinking that if he's not going to kill his relatives is going to be with him eternally. This is not possible. So in the same way, when a situation comes where we have to make decisions based on present situation, we actually think of that, like if we don't do that, then it is we are going to be benefited. But it is not going to happen like that. And if you have to make any decision that is going to affect our life, it is said that we have to have three pramanas, which is sadhu, guru, and shastra. Means sadhu means the persons who are well known or who are in the path of spiritual advancement. They are sadhus. And gurus means who are connected to us. And shastras means scriptures. We have to make reference of them and make decisions. And Arjuna is now Krishna is referring to Arjuna, saying that you are worrying about these bodies, but these bodies are temporary. And Krishna says, "Dehinosmi neta dehe kaumaram yavanam jara tahata dehantara praptir dhiras tatrana mukheti." Means this body continuously passes through birth, old age, disease, and death. It takes birth, it grows up, and it at the end of old age, it gives up that body and take a new body. And this material body is perishable, but the Atma within the body, the spirit soul within the body is eternal. And that soul, which is within the body, that never dies. We already covered the difference between the soul and the body in the previous session. Like in the first session only we discussed, right? We are not this body, we are a spirit soul, like that. So Krishna also gives the example of changing bodies is like changing of clothes. So when we want to do good for anybody, we only do good on the material, like the physical level. Means we give some food, we give nice clothing, or we make them feel good. But these are all on the physical or at least on the mental level only. But on the spiritual level, if you do good to someone, that is the best benefit. That is going to solve their problem for all time to come. Because when we give the right knowledge, maybe they may be our friends or maybe relatives or maybe our parents. If you give them the spiritual knowledge or connect to Krishna consciousness, then they are going to be eternally benefited, and they can get liberated even from this cycle of birth and death. That is the greatest benefit that we can do for our relatives. And then, I'm sorry, I'm not following the slides actually. So then after explaining that, Krishna also explained the characteristics of the soul. For the soul, there is no beginning, and there is no death also, no, because soul existed eternally. And soul, it takes up a body and then gives body. It's a, the body is temporary, but the soul is eternal. So after explaining the characteristics of the soul, Krishna goes ahead and explains about duty. So why Krishna explained about the characteristics of the soul? Because what was Arjuna's first concern? His first concern was, if I fight this war, I'm going to kill my relatives. For that, Krishna gives the example, you are not killing your relatives. Even you are only killing their, you are only destroying the bodies, and they are going to get another body as soon as they are destroyed. And then second reason is, he is concerned about sinful reactions. If we kill others, then we'll get sinful reactions. Further, Krishna gives the example of performing the prescribed duty. Like, you know, he wants to like the second reason was, he was not forcing any enjoyment, because in fighting war, he is not like, if I fight and if I kill all my relatives, I'm not going to gain anything. And if I win the kingdom, whom am I going to show? Because the purpose of the wealth is to be happy with your, not only for yourself, but with all your friends and relatives. But if all your friends and relatives are killed, and whom will you share your happiness with? For sharing, no, it is said that, right, if you share your happiness, it will double, and it will, if you share your miseries, they become by half. So sharing is always required. But Krishna is saying, if you perform your duty, prescribed duty correctly, it will give greater enjoyment. Means it may not be able to visibly give so-called enjoyment in on this material platform, but you will be promoted to a higher heavenly planets. And also, if you don't do your duty, if Arjuna gives up this battlefield, and his enemies will mock at him, he says, Arjuna gave up this battlefield only out of fear of sinful reactions. Fear of other party, means out of fear only. You're able to listen, right, Prabhu? Deepak Prabhu?
Yes, Prabhuji.
So that's the reason. So that is Krishna gave the difference between the body and the soul. That is the first reason. And the second reason was the actual enjoyment. No, if Arjuna is thinking that by fighting this battlefield, he will not be able to be happy. But Arjuna is saying, you will be really happy, because you are not only getting benefited in this world. If he wins this battlefield, he will get the kingdom of this world. And because of performing his duty properly, he will be promoted to the heavenly planets, and he will enjoy in the next life also. And he will get better in the next life also. But if he neglects his duty, anyhow, he's already exploited by these wicked cousins, the relatives. And again, he will be sent to the hell because of neglecting his duty. So Krishna is saying, Krishna is giving the two ways in which he will be happy. And then Krishna says about performing your duty without any expectations. And for that, he describes Nishkama Karma Yoga, or detached work. He says, Neha Bikrama Nashosti Pratyavayona Vidyate Solvamapyasa Dharmasya Trayate Mahato Bayat. If you do your duty with proper knowledge, even a little bit of endeavor on this path will give you ultimate results. So it will actually save you from greater dangers. That is the buddhi yoga, means for the thought design is giving, because fear of sinful reaction. The thought design Arjuna gave is, if I am going to kill my relatives, I am going to get some sinful reaction. So in this world, everything is associated with certain kind of karma. Even if you do the so-called good karma, or if you do anything, if you think that I am doing good, but unknowingly or knowingly, we commit many sinful reactions, many acts which involve sin. We may not be knowing that it is a sin, but we unknowingly do that kind of activities. So there Krishna is saying, but if you with Nishkama Karma Yoga, means without, if you perform without any expectation of the result, no, then it won't give any reactions. No, how we gave the example of soldier, right, in the beginning, like how if a soldier kills the opposite the armies of other party, he is not going to get any reaction. Nobody is going to blame him. And on the other hand, he will be awarded many medals and rewards because of fighting for the nation by the king, right? But if the same soldier comes and kills his neighbor, he will be put in the jail. So if we work on behalf of Krishna, if you work only to establish dharma, then we will not be getting any reactions. So we have to change, we don't have to give up our work, but we have to change the why, the consciousness, the purpose for which we are working for. That will save us from great amount of dangers. So then Krishna says, Krishna also discourages Arjuna not to follow these Vedic things. Traigunya Vishaya Veda Nistraigunya Bhavarjuna Nirdvanda Nitya Satvastho Niryoga Kshema Matmavan. Means Krishna says, actually these slides are not required only. I'm just referring. I think these slides are better because those slides are so much information, you cannot go faster with those slides. Okay. So now Krishna is encouraging Arjuna to perform Nishkama Karma Yoga, means to work but without any reaction. So, but according to Vedic thing, Vedas are considered as Pramana. But why Krishna is, if Vedas are pramana, means Vedas are the reference for leading the life, then why Krishna is asking Arjuna to, you know, to neglect Vedas? Because Krishna is saying Vedas deals with, Vedas deals with three modes, and Krishna is encouraging Arjuna to rise above the three modes. And we will see how, like, Krishna is encouraging about rising above three modes, because by performing karma yoga, we already discussed, right? What is yoga? Yoga means, yoga comes from the root word yuj. Yuj means to reconnect what that is lost, because there used to be a relation between the individual soul and the supreme soul, the God himself. So that relation we have to reconnect. Means, like, if any process that reconnects the individual soul to the super soul is called yoga. So when one performs any activities that are involved, like karma yoga, dhyana yoga, ashtanga yoga, bhakti yoga, if one performs his activity in those terms, then his action will be free of any reactions, because it is addressing at the parodharma, means highest dharma. What is highest dharma? To be able, like, you are the spirit soul, and you have, by your nature, you have a relationship with the supreme soul. And if you work towards that goal, not to re-establish that lost relationship, then you will be free from all the sinful reactions. It is like, you know, acting for the sake of Krishna. So that is why Krishna is saying, just by even svalpam apyasa dharmasya, means if you follow even little bit of dharma, then trahato mayato bhata, it will liberate you from the greatest sinful reactions. So that's why we already explained, right, how that is karma, vikarma, and akarma. Karma is performing the one's own duties, you know, that will give good results. And vikarma means bad activities that gives bad reactions. And akarma is, will actually, it neither give good results and neither give bad results. See, like, good results means binding up with a golden chain. Bad results means binding up with an iron chain. But both of them are chains. Both of them are going to bind us to this material world. But if you do akarma, we will be liberated from this material world once and for all. So that is what Krishna is encouraging Arjuna to do. Yes, Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
I'm not seeing any. Are you sharing any screen, right?
Oh, sorry. You're not able to see, right?
Yeah.
I forgot to share.
Yeah.
Let me connect this. But you are able to follow Tina?
Yes. Also having the hard copy of that Gita.
But you are able to follow till now, right?
Yes.
Okay. So then, after explaining the how the karma should be done, like Krishna explained about importance of duty first. First he explained about the characteristics of soul, and how acting on the platform of spiritual level is going to give permanent result. Otherwise, if he works on the bodily level, all the results that comes for the on the bodily level, they go off with the body level. For example, if you work only for money and you earn a lot of millions of dollars or rupees, and then at the time of death you are not able to even take single rupee with you, and you have to leave all the accumulated wealth just in this world and just give it to somebody. That's it. That is working on the bodily platform. Or if you do good on the body, or if you do good on the bodily platform for your relatives, for society, or for anything, then they will only remember as long as they are getting some good results. They are going the good comfort from you. As long as some results are gone, means like if you are not able to satisfy their senses, they are going to just forget about you and neglect you, or even they develop hatred towards you also, because you give so much enjoyment till now, but you are not giving them. They think that it is in, everything is in your hands. So that is another thing. So, and the second thing is, Krishna says, rightly performing your duties is gives a great, better enjoyment than not performing your duty. For that, he gave the example of, how Arjuna will be blamed and blasphemed, and if he gives up his duty, he will be sent to the hellish punishments, like that. But if he performs his duty of fighting the war to establish dharma, then if he gets the kingdom, he is going to be happy in this material world. And even after this life, he will be promoted to the higher destinations. And then he explains about acting on platform of detached work without reactions. How not acting for your own benefit, but for the sake of establishing dharma, means for the sake of Krishna. That will give us even, that will free us one from the, even from the reactions of our work. Then, then Krishna explains about the characteristics of the perfect person, means how a perfect person acts, means he is called Sita Pragna. He is also a liberated soul. A perfect person means he will be staying in this body, but he is a liberated soul, he is a Jivan Mukta. Jivan Mukta means he is present in that body, but he is not bound yet. So Jivan Mukta is the one who gives up all kinds of material desires that arise from the mind and then satisfied within the self is said to be Sita Pragna. That is the qualities of the Sita Pragna. Means he does not hanker for anything external. Means he works. If anything comes, if some pleasurable thing comes in his life, he takes it and he accepts it. But if doesn't come, he does not hanker for it. He is not too much running after material sense gratification. He is satisfied. Means being self-satisfied is more important. That is what Krishna is saying here. And he, he is not disturbed in the mind amidst of the threefold miseries. He is not elated when there is happiness, and he is free from attachment, fear, and anger. Such persons are called sage of steady mind. He is unaffected everywhere in this world by whatever good or evil he may obtain, neither prizing or despising him. Such person is firmly fixed in perfect knowledge. So, let me see. Means he does not, for his happiness, he does not depend on the externals. Means happiness is an internal matter. Happiness is within. If you see, there is a nice story actually, there was one king, and he said, "Can anybody show me a very happy, peaceful person? Then I will go. I'm going to award him a 1,000 gold coins. Like whoever shows him a person with peace of mind and a very happy, leading a happy life, I'm going to award him a 1,000 gold coins." Then what happens? One person comes and shows a farmer. A farmer lives in a hut with his wife and with his children. He has a small tract of land, and he is just with his ox and bulls, and he goes to farmland, and then he tills the land, he does nice farming, and then comes home and lives peacefully, and he is always happy with his wife and children, just getting whatever comes from the farmland, he is taking it and living peacefully. One person shows king, tells the king that about this farmer. This farmer doesn't hanker for anything. He lives very happily. he does not hanker for wealth, name, fame, or anything. And I see that he is the most happy person without any anxieties. And this king says, okay, that's very nice. And take your gold coins, this 100 gold coins for you for showing that. And this king has a minister. He said, wait, king. King, please wait. I have to test this farmer. If after my testing, if this farmer still remains happy, then we can award him 100 gold coins. So what this minister does, he will take a bag of gold coins, 100 gold coins, and then he takes one gold coin out of them and keeps a bag of 99 gold coins in front of this farmer's hut, means farmer's home. So, that farmer is observed, how he reacts for this wealth and all. So next day morning, that farmer, he wakes up and he opens the door. And he sees the bag of, some bag laying in front of his front door. So he picks up that bag and says, there are gold coins. Oh, this is gold. And then he started counting. 1, 2, 3, and said, oh, 98 and 99. Oh, this is just one gold coin, less 200 gold coins. So what I will do now? I'm going to work so hard and going to create one more gold coin. And I will have 100 gold coins. I will be so rich. He thinks like that. And from that day onwards, he starts working left and right. And he does overtime. He does part-time. He does work on the weekends. He does whatnot. He does all the things that whatever he has to, he has to do. He sets up a family business. He makes himself materially so miserable just for the sake of getting one more gold coin. And he loses all his happiness in the life. So that is the criteria of most of us. When we don't have any material facility, we were happy, we are peaceful, contented with whatever we have. But as soon as we get something in this material world, we strive to, we have to improvise. Then we don't have, for 15 years back, we don't even have cell phones, internet, nothing we had. And we were happy, watching whatever there and reading books or discussing Krishna Katha or sometimes in a weekend one movie in a week we're happy that like that, right? We're very peaceful. And this technology, what it says, this technology is a false promise. It comes into our life saying that I will make you more happy, and it introduces internet, it introduces television, it introduces cinemas, it introduces newspapers, and so much information given to us, and we think that we are just missing that one more gold coin. If we just have one more gold coin, we'll be very perfect. And we start working so hard, we neglect our family, we neglect our devotion, we neglect our spiritual life, we neglect our health, we neglect our friends, and we are running after money and running. And we are missing the whole point of our life only. Actually, we are missing our life itself. So, means that is like happiness is within. That happiness should be found within. There is no limit for the sense gratification. The more you give for the senses will demand more and more and more. There is no limit. A person with, who has hardly have any money will be more happy and contented than a millionaire or billionaire. That billionaire will be struggling, working hard day and night, to make that 1 billion into 2 billion. What for? After some time, we're going to lose everything. But that if that same duty is performed as a service to the Krishna, that will give greater happiness. Means he will work. He will work as much as required. And he will not worry about the result. In this modern day lifestyle, this worrying kills more than the actual work. Thinking, worrying about the result, worrying about expectations, worrying different things. If you are happy just by doing what is your duty, then that will be, that is the quality of Sthita Pragna. So for that, one should be, one should be very careful not to engage our senses into sense gratification too much. It is very difficult. Just like our senses, when the our senses got attached to the object of sense gratification. Like I just want to see something like nice movies and something like amazing dance performances. If then eyes will pull in the direction. If nose is something addicted to something, and if a tongue is addicted to eating nice food stuff, it will pull us in some directions. If no, if our skin wants different kind of no, what do you call sparsha, means like the sense of touch to opposite sex or anything like that, it will pull in that direction. So Krishna is saying one should control his senses first, and then just by controlling our senses, our mental anxiety will go down by many fold. Then we have to aim for the higher taste. What is higher taste? Being satisfied on a spiritual platform. If you see some sages, some devotees, they'll be very happy and very bindas sitting in a corner of the temple, chanting or reading Bhagavatam or Bhagavad Gita, and discussing stories about Krishna. They don't need internet, they don't need phone, they don't need opposite sex, they don't need friends. They are so content, they don't need anything. They'll be sitting in one corner of the temple and happy with whatever the facilities they have. But if on the other hand, like a person who is in the material world, he might be having so like a palatial building, so many cars and so much of bank balance, but still he will be so miserable. That is means the when we put more and more, because senses will increase, overload our mind with a lot of expectations and a lot of anchorings. So even a man of discrimination, senses are so strong and impetuous that forcefully carry the mind. Means the senses will pull the mind in different directions and will not let the mind to be peaceful. One who restrains his senses and fixes his consciousness upon Krishna, keeps the senses under full control, is known as man of steady intelligence. So, what is the best way to control the senses? By fixing them on Krishna. Means if you want to see, go to temple and see nice darshan, if you want to decorate, if you have the anchoring for decoration, decorate the deity of Krishna. And if you want to eat foodstuff, then first offer everything to Krishna and then eat as a prasad. And look, that is the easiest way of controlling the senses. You don't have to go into Himalayas and do austerities for thousands of years and then, but still you will not be able to control the senses. Easiest way of controlling the senses is put our senses, just like how Arjuna's chariot, the senses are compared to the wild horses. And these wild horses, when we keep Krishna in the position of a chariot, in the heart of our chariot, and when we give the control of the chariot to Krishna, then it is easy for him to control. Krishna's name is Hrishikesha, means controller of senses. So we will not, with our humanly efforts, we will not be able to control our senses, but Krishna is, he is the master of the senses. He can easily control the senses. So how, but when the senses are uncontrolled, what will happen? Then senses will contemplate on the sense object, means meditating on the opposite sex or something illegal, something like that. And then from contemplation, attachment develops. The senses will get attachment to the sense object. Means different senses have different sense object. Eyes have the sense object of watching different nice things. And ears have hearing good about ourselves. And nose has smelling something nice. And like that, different senses have different sense object which agitates them, which alludes them. And from that attachment, lust develops. How come lust develops? Because attachment between the senses and sense object is called lust. No? Like anything it can be. What is the difference between lust and love? Lust is something for our own sense gratification. Love is something for the Krishna sense gratification. When the same thing engaged, because if you want to sing, if you want to sing cinema songs, that is lust. But if you sing the same in the praising Krishna, that is love. Means doing something other than Krishna's service, means like that will increase the conditioning of our senses. Means like you cannot turn off a flame by pouring petrol on that or gasoline on that, right? Petrol can be like a fire can be extinguished by not supplying the fuel to the fire can be extinguished by not supplying the fuel to it. So senses are like wildfires. Senses are like fire. When we give more and more sense gratification, means objects of senses to the senses, the hankering in the senses, the fire will grow more and more, and it will make more unstable. But if the senses are so wild, and if their sense gratification, the object of sense gratification is not provided to them. Means any of your kid is playing a video game, and if you take out that video game and then say do something else, and he will go crazy, he will become angry, he will become shouts, and he does whatnot, you know? That anger develops because you are taking the object from his senses, you know? Object of his sense gratification from his sense, from him. That's why this anger develops. From this anger, this delusion, means the confusion develops. From confusion, bewilderment of memory. The memory is lost. From the loss of memory, due to loss of memory, intelligence is lost. When the intelligence is lost, then he will fall down. Means when the intelligence is lost, he don't know what he is working, you know, how what he is doing. He doesn't discriminate. He lives like an animal. And he falls down into the material world. Due to that, he will acquire a lot of sinful reactions, and then he'll again fall down in the material world again. So one who is free from the attachment, you know, what is the best way to get out of this entanglement is, one who is free from attachment means when we control our senses in the beginning itself, you know, when the flame is low, it is better to stop supplying to the senses. You know, when the flame of attachment is will be controlled, and aversion and engage his senses in the sense objects, and with the controlment and regulative principles of freedom attains peace and mercy of the Lord. Means when we follow the regulative principles, means we don't have to completely stop our sense gratification, but it has to be regulated. No, like a horse can be brought under control with proper training. Like it's not like a wild horse cannot be rided. No, it has to be properly trained. No, so that's why riders take the wild horse and trains it very nicely for many days. And after that, once it is properly trained, then it will listen whatever the command it is given to them. In the same way, our senses are right now are very wild. But when we regulate them, means like for suppose, if you are watching like, you know, 5 movies in a week, then regulate it. Make like, you know, first make it like 3 movies. Then after a few weeks, make it 2 movies. Then after weeks, weekly once a movie. And then like monthly once. Then like once in 2 months, like that. Like that we regulate, and then finally give up. And also any, like that's a gross example that I give. Any sense object, you know, you are hankering after money, hankering after sense gratification, hankering after anything that can be regulated. Anything can be regulated in this world. So that's why we have 4 regulative principles: no meat eating, no intoxication, no gambling, no illicit sex. So when we regulate, first we have to do that on a gross level. And then once we become perfect on the gross level, when perfectly we are following these principles on the gross level, means physically no illicit sex, physically no meat eating, physically no intoxication, physically no gambling. And then when we perfect that stage, then we have to move to the next stage where we do it in a subtle level, means unsensitive levels, means no meat eating, means like what is unsense on the subtle level, means we should not hanker for, you know, insulting others or hurting others, others feeling. We should be, even on the on thinking level also, we should be very careful like that. And then no intoxication means not running after name, fame, that kind of intoxication. No gambling means not even thinking about lying or, you know, or false propagandas, you know, or talking nonsense, that kind of thing. So like that, you know, if there is, we have to raise the standards of our regulations gradually until we become a perfect person, perfect devotee. And at that point when we reach that stage, we'll be happy. It will be our mind will be very peaceful and we don't run off our sense gratification. So agitated senses carry away the intelligence, means when the senses are agitated, the intelligence doesn't work. So a sthita prajna, like for a sthita prajna, for a person of proper intelligence, for a materialistic person, what is daytime in the, for a materialistic person, that is nighttime. And what is the nighttime for a sense controlled person is daytime for a materialistic person. Means whatever the enjoyment a materialistic person finds, a sense control means a sthita prajna, means a devotee doesn't find the enjoyment in them. But whatever the enjoyment that a devotee finds, the materialistic person cannot find enjoyment in that. For example, if you see, all the devotees will wake up early in the morning. Means the sense controlled person, they wake up early in the morning. At that point of time, our mind will be very peace and will be taking very nice mature decisions. But a materialistic person, what does he do? He wakes up very late, you know, sometimes 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, sometimes 12 o'clock, 11 o'clock, like that. Means like there are three modes, means there are sattvagun, they are mode of goodness, passion and ignorance. Goodness will be most, the morning time will be mode of goodness, early morning from 2 a.m. until 6:30 a.m. That is mode of goodness. Means whatever you do at that point of time, you will be, your mind will be very peaceful and your concentration is very good. Whatever you think is most important in life, at that point of time, you should do that. So that's why all the great devotees and great sages, they use that time. And after that, from 6:30 to until evening 6 p.m., it is mode of passion. Means a lot of working here and there, running. It will be mode of passion. And from 7 p.m. until night 2, it is mode of ignorance. If you see all the restaurants, bars, and all the clubs, they open in the night time because that is the mode of ignorance. Nobody will you party at 4 a.m. in the morning because that is the modes doesn't match. Means the person cannot enjoy nicely in the morning hours. But his morning hours are the meant for mode of goodness. Means for sadhana, means having a higher taste, having something, achieving something higher in life. So like that's whatever a materialist enjoy, a sthita prajna, a sense controlled person does not do that. So, and this perfect person, a sthita prajna, is unagitated by any sense desires. And he has given up objects of sense enjoyment and he is without desire, except for bodily maintenance. And he has given up the sense of possessiveness. And he is devoid of false ego. Such a person is alone can attain real peace. A person not disturbed by incessant flow of desires. And enters like in a river. Even like desires are coming, he is not disturbed because he is not reacting to them. Like our mind may give a lot of disturbances to us. It may agitate us so much. But if you don't act upon them, we may get anger. But if you don't act upon the anger, if you may get temptation, we may become lusty. But if you don't act upon it, or you do something that will increase that lust more, then gradually our mind will become controlled and will not respond to that kind of agitations. Then we'll be able to attain the real peace, and we'll be focusing on the achieving the higher taste in our lives. So that is the end of this chapter. So if you have any questions, we can discuss now. Hare Krishna, Prabhupada. Arvind Sharma Prabhu, Hare Krishna. Prabhuji, are you able to follow?
Yes.
Okay, good. Is it Deepak Prabhu? Is it you, Arvind Sharma?
This is Arvind.
Huh?
Yeah. This is Arvind.
Oh, okay, Prabhu. You are able to follow it, right? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Any questions?
No.
Okay, we'll end it here. Rantra Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Ananda Koti Vaishnava Vrinda ki jai.
Jai.